So when will that come before this committee?
As things stand, the next meeting of this committee is early July, if I'm not mistaken. I'm chairing it to Councillor Gilchrist, ask if there could be a special meeting of this committee to deal with that. Available within due time before the election. Not necessarily a pre-election period, but just the election itself, so members will be free to attend.
Would the work be done quickly enough for that to be feasible?
The timescale I'm looking towards, as I say, is having that report completed by the end of March, if we then need to go through a quality assurance check in the week, so it would be very early into April, I would say. I'm not too sure in terms of the community cycling
Chair, you would be within the pre-election period, but this is, if I may say, perhaps strict, not when you would call business as usual, but in terms of applications to the local authority publicity code, I would consider this business as usual. This is continuing business on council, not an announcement of some new initiative or action, so the application of the pre-election period, of course, wouldn't count. So if you wish to have a meeting in mid to late April, then you could.
Okay, I've got Phil.
Used the opportunity of recent discussions to look at the Audit and Governance Committee of your council on the 22nd of February 2017. Whilst that's partly redacted, there's certain discussions about companies and the way in which the possible ways in which the gentleman bought services from other companies which he had some involvement with. So I would suggest, based on what Mr. McCourt said, I'll move this at this point. A further committee meeting be arranged as soon as possible to consider the results of the further investigations and progress with any subsequent investigatory work and the points raised by members this evening. So I've carefully written any and progress with subsequent investigatory work in case Mr. Niblock isn't quite ready on any particular things he's still clarifying. I'm conscious that my email that committee members have showed that in March and April 2017 I was asking of officers what information could be checked up upon this individual. So that might have produced further work, and that might be a separate strand. So okay, I'm not going into great detail on that, but I have moved some wording which I hope will be acceptable.
That's a proposition, I think. The gist of your proposition was a meeting as soon as possible.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Now, I've also got Paul John on the same subject.
Yeah, look, I'm quite alarmed, actually. Yes, sorry. Quite alarmed actually that some of this information has actually been discussed in a public meeting, because I consider quite a bit of it commercially confidential. However, to suggest that we have a follow-on meeting to this during PIRDA is absolute nonsense. Some of this could definitely be construed as political cannon fodder, and I just cannot agree that you would have another meeting during PIRDA on this subject and in such a way with commercially confidential information in the public realm. I just can't understand how it's even being considered.
Can we just deal with that? Because there's nothing commercial or confidential in here.
There are two comments made there. One is what may or may not be discussed in the public meeting. What's before you, when we've reviewed it, we feel that it is entirely reasonable for what's here to be in front of you. Now there is further discussion that you may have and further votes you may go down. So for example, I have drafted letters, lawyer to lawyer, to the former directors of this company and to their solicitors to interrogate the events that have happened and to assist HMRC in their investigations. That's not true. I'd be happy to brief members in a private sphere on that. But that point it has crossed the line for
from the results of this investigation, which I wholly concur in some places is light, but it's light perhaps for that reason, because there are personal details, personal circumstances, and elements that may be contested in a future court case that are before you. As I said, my involvement has been very much about looking backwards from when I was involved in these events, and certainly have only gone as far as the actions of this company in relation to these particular events. And certainly, I have been involved in some of the earlier questions that have been raised about the appointment of the company in the first place, for example, which are purely an audit matter. So, I hope that gives you some comfort about what isn't discussed here. As for the second point, as I say, this is a matter of concern for the committee. It's entirely up to you whether you have feel you need to have a committee and when, and obviously your reasonings for that may not come from other places, as we're in an election period, is a matter of pure politics for yourselves, as much as we can comment on it.
Well, no, I'm in some difficulty because we have a proposal from Phil, which is that a further meeting of this committee shall be convened as soon as possible.
Seconded.
I would take that to be as feasible as well as to be possible. It must be feasible to do it. To be feasible, it must be that we must have sufficient information before it for it to be a meaningful meeting. But we have the proposition before us that there should be a meeting as early, I think, as is practical. Does that sum up what you mean, Phil?
Well, one agenda item, aren't we?
This is for a specific topic. I wrote carefully and progress with any subsequent investigatory work, which I think would cover the question of whether we were good to go at the appropriate date.
Well, come back.
The question is whether there should be a period of further crisis action, and that's the point I'm raising. With all due respect to the officers, they're not politicians, and some of this information is political cannon fodder, or could be made to be such. And so, to me, I take your point about commercial confidentiality, but I'm saying the fact that individuals and invoices have been discussed, it could be construed in all sorts of ways, and it should not be held during further.
Can I help? Because I would like to potentially contrast and compare the work of the York Audit and Governance Committee that actually got right into the guts of these issues without any, politics either, but actually spent the time getting into the issues to make sure they found out what went on in order to stop it happening again. And I think that's the key thing. What I find a little disconcerting is that Paul believes that we should slow this down because he thinks there are political points to be made. What I'm interested in is making sure that we have an assurance framework around the council that makes sure we don't have the chief executive making an appointment on the 24th of January when we knew back in October, as was pointed out by Cathy. But certainly,
the
senior
level, the same ground again and again.
Well, that's what we need to have. We need to have a meeting.
It has been seconded. Sure. I think we should go to a vote on it.
Sure, if it helps, I have no issue with further. I think there's lots of investigations, and I concur with, we need to be answering some questions here. I'm just talking about the timing of a meeting, and it should not be held during further. I doubt it was in your.
We have the proposal on the floor.
No, Chair, I just wanted to clarify a point because some of the discussion has been about taking this investigation and focusing it to narrower points that have been raised as questions this evening. But my understanding, and I'm not sure, is that the audits that are coming actually rather than drilling down into these very particular issues, are actually extrapolating the learning points from this and looking wider. So the Audit I Commission, for example, was to say, well, if this happened with this one company, how do we know it's not happening with lots of others? And that was my question. That's the work that I have commissioned Mark to do, and is the work that's coming back. So just to clarify, in the work he's currently undertaking, as a result of this, is narrowing down to finite points of who did what and when in terms of appointing this company, but the learning points from this exercise, which is how can it not happen again, and in terms of VAT and the processes that are in place, when alerts are flagged up, and actually how do we know now that half the companies we're contracting with are using false VAT registration, as you saw. So that's the way it's coming.
I'm sorry, but I think it's politically naive if that's what you think, that this type of investigation could be carried out and further meetings held during further.
Chair, it's not for me to make a political comment or not, or to be savvy to the politics that members may take from this. I'm fully aware that Audit Committee can be used as a political tool. I'm just saying it's not my place to comment.
I'm going to take this to a vote now. Phil, just for absolute clarity, please read your proposition.
Yes, I'll read it for the
vote. And go straight to a vote.
Very kind. A further committee meeting will be arranged as soon as possible to consider the results of the further investigations and progress with subsequent investigatory work and the points raised by members.
And I seconded that, Chair.
Okay, that's been proposed and seconded. Let's please go to a vote. All those in favour, please show. 4, 5, 6 in favour, that's clearly carried. I suppose I should say those against.
Absolutely.
Okay. Alright, but that's 6-2. So it has been carried. Right. Now let's take a deep breath. Go on to the next item on the agenda. I think that we can say what we have now. I think we'll agree the recommendation. Yes? On to item 4. Medium term financial strategy. Chair, this is for you.
Thank you, Chair. So, members will remember committees ago. Members have requested some further information from that committee about the medium term financial strategy that was presented and approved at the Council for 2017-18 up to 2021. So the reporters are looking back on what's happened when that was originally approved at Council, and also we're looking forward on what is happening for the next 4 years in terms of our medium-term financial strategy from next year, which was approved at Council on the 4th of March. So just take you through a couple of the items in the report, Chair. So in 3.1, paragraph 3.1, there's a table there, which is the actual MTFF, the medium-term financial strategy that members were concerned about and wanted information on from 2017-18 up to 2021, which originally proposed some saving proposals of just over 40 million to meet the gap that was there at that time. In paragraphs sort of 3.3 and down to the end of 3.7, that just provides information on what those savings proposals were at the time and the progress that had been made to date on those proposals. So because the MTFS is a dynamic piece of work, it's a dynamic strategy, it's never fixed because unfortunately things are stay static within the world of central and local government and legislation as well. So we have to constantly keep updating the MTFS all the time, and to not do so, you know, would put the council in a very vulnerable position in terms of its financial sustainability. So things have moved on since 2017-18. I mean, the information is there to say the progress has been made. Some of the savings have been achieved, some of them are ongoing and will be achieved, but some things have changed, and as a result of that, we've taken those savings that are unachievable out of the MTFS for 2019-20 over the next 4 years.
Sorry, just to help, the thing I might be the one who bangs on about whether the much as, you know, if it's in a table and a report, it must therefore be true. What I haven't seen, and what I was expecting, was the actual programme. This is listing out a series of savings, although the children's services actually spent more rather than save. So, what I would have liked to see is the actual programmes that had been run under this heading to see if they had actually delivered the benefit. All this is saying is a whole series of savings were made in various departments and you've decided to earmark them against the change programme rather than being clear whether the change, and then say, there we go, we're going to make it, we can all move on, not stop worrying about it.
The change programme that you talk about, I think, is the Delivering Differently programme. And that change programme was presented to Council and agreed by Cabinet in December and 16 and March 17. And the whole change programme was this programme. So the information you've got here is the basis of that change programme, Delivering Differently. And it was those five areas that made up the basis of that change programme. Now, some of those items in that programme are continuing as planned. For example, the adult social care integration programme that was submitted is still on track. That's still going ahead. Some of those items in the change programme have not gone as planned, and there are mitigating reasons for those. But some of them, most of the items in the change programme happened in 2021, so we're not at the point yet where those would have been delivered anyway. And what we've done, what I've done, since being in post, is to re-evaluate those and review them and actually have a look, will they be achievable, will they be feasible, reassess them, and in some cases they won't be achievable, will they be feasible, because things have moved on. So I've actually taken them out of the programme so that they're not stuck in and they're unachievable targets.
Well, can I ask this then for you, Chair, rather than delay or detain this committee in, while we go through the detail of that. Can I come and see you? You could show me what's in the programme, what's been taken out, and what that actually means. Because we took on a range of staff to deliver this particular programme. And if we're not delivering it, or we're changing what's being delivered, then that is, you know, what's the point of having these programme years?
So it's just not delivering to you, Jeff.
Good, thank you. I'm retired now, sure, as well, so I can come. You'd be delighted to hear.
Okay, anything else on the report? Anything else on item 4?
No.
We'll accept the recommendation. All the time now, Mark, it's back to you, the internal audit update.
Thank you, Chair. This is a regular report I present to members of this committee, containing information relating to the delivery of the internal audit service. This particular report comes at the very 1st of January through to the 20th of February 2015. Both those concentrates on items identified for escalation from the Land Office reports, provide performance data relating to the internal audit service, and identify some developments that take place within the service. Your attention is specifically drawn to section 3.2, page 72 of the committee papers, where a number of items have been identified regarding the work that have been undertaken by the recently attended internal audit. Members should also note section 3.3 on page 74 of the report to identify other recommendations that remain outstanding beyond the agreed action date with no progress being made. There's one item currently identified here which is currently subject of a detailed follow-up that was started this week, so we should know the outcome of that within days. Section 3.4 of the report, I identify information relating to the performance of the internal audit service and note the delivery of the other plans on target. Feedback from clients remains very good. Key actions identified by the reports have been agreed with clients, and the client satisfaction levels have remained consistently high. Section 3.5 on page 75 of the report identifies some of the continuing improvements that have been made to delivery service. Regular feature of this report and provided for me to demonstrate that we are undertaking ongoing actions to try and develop. Members are asked to note the report, take any appropriate action if you appropriate. And I'm happy to take any questions that members might have.
Are there any questions?
Just a quick one, and again, this is a good report. It's good to see that our level of compliance with recommendations, it's a shame we have to keep making recommendations, but the compliance with recommendations is going up. So, well done, you and the team, and the corporate management, one presumes, because this change normally starts with evidence at the top that that's what you expect. So that's to the good. Can I just check, because the committee has a priority, because we've just voted on it, to make sure that that this report is done as soon as possible and is reported to the committee, whether you've got the resources. And just in terms of some of this other stuff, I'm hoping it will pick up the issue of direct payroll payment as opposed to temporary payment, just in case a year is employing someone for years and sound like a temporary blip in order we need to go to the market to fill. So we will pick up some of those issues too. So you've got the resources to do that.
There's the answer.
Good. Phil?
There's a fairly similar line. Just wanted to check exactly where we are with the signing of the growth commitment.
Everyone's announced it's been done, hasn't it? Have you signed it, Angela?
No, John's an update. So, do you want me to answer that, Phil?
Yes, we're most grateful, because it does affect workload and it turns up in the plan later.
And perhaps Philip can back it up afterwards, if that's all right. You can say what you like.
I'm
hearing every word.
Yeah, okay. So, where we're up to at the moment, obviously it's been gone through Muse and Morgan Sindall board, and then we're hoping to have it signed by the end of next week.
Hello?
Thank you.
Is that what you were going to say?
Yes, Chair, there's one side agreement on what's called a corporate services agreement, which we had originally planned to sign off before everything else was signed, but actually we're looking to try and bump that so that we can sign that. As you say, the plan is to have it.
This isn't like the equivalent to the backstop one.
No, it's simply about...
No, there's no conservatives against the
So it's about nailing down, for example, who's doing the company secretarial services and how the company will be paying for them. So that kind of level of detail. So there is that, and there have been a couple of questions come through from our lawyers and theirs that we want to nail down before we say to you, yes, it's time to sign. So we hope to have the process in place by Friday, so fingers crossed next week. May require perhaps phone calls and shouting at lawyers. I know you will hate that.
Only because they don't listen.
So with those assurances, can we not the report period? Well, we're still with Mark, obviously right on 6 now, the internal audit annual plan. This is your regular one, Mark.
This is a report that I present to the Members of the Committee on an annual basis and identifies the internal audit plan work for 2019-20. The plan does contain an explanation of how it was prepared, identifies a list of proposed areas to be audited during 2019-20. The main points to note are that the service operates on a 12-monthly planning cycle in line with current professional best practice. This ensures that every effort is utilised as efficiently and effectively as possible to mitigate risks in what is a highly changing environment we're operating in. The current public sector environment or the plan needs to be flexible and need to be dynamic. We need to ensure that the organisational change is factored into that process and the board is going to be within the plan to reflect the changing risk profile and organisation. This is particularly important for the council at present. As I just alluded, there are many fundamental changes taking place regarding the way the services are being delivered. This will undoubtedly present a significant and different kind of risks to those perhaps who would actually experience. The audit plan is designed to inform that process, provide relevant assurance opinions on systems either in place or developing, provides direction assessments regarding actions required, and then the necessary improvements required. The plan does policy will be linked to the corporate risk register. The actual assurances that will be obtained during the audit area. The scope of the audit is that the day will be agreed with senior management prior to commencement. This ensures that key current risks are being addressed in year rather than laying down something before you know that it will change because of what I just described. The plan has been devised following a risk-based approach, professional risk-based approach, in line with public sector audit standards that we comply with. Utilises a variety of different sources, including not the least of the corporate risk register, department risk registers, engagement with all senior officers throughout the organisation, a review of the external audit and inspection reports presented, a review of our corporate strategies, policies and procedures, and not least of the cumulative audit document experience, engagement with other heads of internal audit outside of the organisation, and our professional judgment on the risk before the scenario has presented. Other points to note are that the allocation of the audit days identified for 2019-20 as identified in section 6 when the report reflects the expansion of the resource available to me. I am confident and believe that this resource will be sufficient to enable delivery across all areas of the plan. It will enable me to provide my annual chief internal officer's assurance opinion. Comparative data obtained from other similar sized public sector internal audit providers indicates that, in my view, will internal service can provide an efficient and affordable service. The audit plan, as I mentioned, will remain flexible, will be reviewed on an ongoing quarterly basis to ensure it remains in line with the emerging risks that are presented. I have regular meetings with chief officers on a quarterly basis